Once again, my name is Mark Woodward, Senior Safety and Risk Trainer with Missouri Employers Mutual. We greatly appreciate your time today. Appreciate you hopping in on our webinar series. Really appreciate your business. And one thing I can't stress enough today is please reach out to us, the MEM team, if you have any questions regarding construction job site safety. So the title of our webinar today is Building Your Business in a Safe Workplace. And so we're going to talk about construction safety primarily from an injury prevention standpoint, from a top-down standpoint with regard to OSHA citations and violations, and hopefully help everyone with a little bit of focus as to what needs to really occur on our job sites. Our job sites are all different. We all do different types of construction. So we're going to try to hit a lot of the commonalities in these construction hazards and incidents and injuries with all of our construction companies. So, you know, take your pen and pad, write down some questions. Don't hesitate to reach out to us. Today, we will not be too formal in our presentation. So don't hesitate to chat in the chat function if you have a question, or reach out to me after the presentation. So we're going to move through our slides. And with every safety presentation that we do at MEM, the challenge is always a zero incident work year, a zero injury year. The challenge is to keep pushing. In your operation, in your company, we want to keep reviewing the written safety rules. We need to keep doing safety meetings. We need to do more safety meetings. We need to enforce the safety rules that we have. We need to inspect equipment, tools, machines, and work areas for unsafe conditions. We need to check with employees on a regular basis to see if they have anything to add or if there's any concerns. We need to keep pushing. There are a lot of employers out there that go entire years without lost workday claims, and we want to help make that the case with your company as well. Zero injuries. That's what we start at today. So on your to-do list, that's where we start. Zero injuries with your operation. And we understand that job sites are all different. Every day is different on a construction job site. We start with planning and site surveys, and then we begin our excavation, and then we pour our concrete, and then we work the building up until we hand the keys over to the new occupants. And every day job sites change. And one of the things that we recommend are regular and routine safety meetings. Are those occurring in your operation? Do we actually take time to do regular job site walkarounds to see if there are unsafe acts or conditions, unsafe machinery that we need to deal with, unsafe tools? Do we do daily safety meetings? And yeah, I'm going to ask for daily safety meetings. Mark at MEM, and darn near all safety meetings that we do, safety webinars, we do really want to see daily safety meetings. It does not hurt to get employees all on the same page that day. It does not hurt to review hazards that get people hurt. Daily safety meetings. Equipment and processes will change. New equipment comes on the job site. Equipment that we're finished with moves off. And problems that we see out there is complacency. One problem is complacency because people, you know, we're comfortable. We haven't really had anything go wrong lately, so we've backed off on our safety meetings. We maybe haven't updated our safety rules lately. We haven't had a safety meeting in a while, haven't had really anybody hurt, so we kind of slack off. Assumptions are another issue. Well, I thought Bob knew. I thought Larry knew. I thought my employees knew not to do that or to do something, but we never did verify. And then another problem that we discuss as well is we're too small. My company's too small. I only have 3 employees. Why do I need to do all the safety stuff? Well, because most of the time with small employers, a lot of those employees are your family and friends. And those employees, if you lose one, now there's just 2 of you. And also, the premium is greatly impacted when we have one of these employee injuries with your construction company. So these are things to think about. Moving ahead, who can help? There are a lot of groups that can help you make your safety and workers' compensation programs and plans very effective. What is your relationship with your insurance agency? What is your relationship with your insurance carrier? If it's MEM, we greatly appreciate your business and wish that you would reach out to us more. Also with Missouri Employers Mutual, you have access to safety and risk services personnel, consultants that you can call and discuss safety issues with. You have access to claims field service managers, our field claims experts. You can always call these folks and they'll help out. The Missouri Department of Labor has a safety consultation program completely free of charge. OSHA compliance assistance personnel can help you. Safety groups like the St. Louis American Society of Safety Professionals. There's a Kansas City chapter, a St. Joe chapter, Central Missouri. Women in Safety and Health, and groups like the Kansas City Construction Safety Group that you can join and participate in. Legal resources and seminars that they do, medical resources. Select Physical Therapy does regular webinars. Those are free of charge and you can attend. Private safety consultants are also out there. So these are just a group of folks that can help you. And we do have some upcoming events that you want to mark your calendar for. On April 21 of 2020, see that? There's a typo right there, 2020. Alan, we'll have to remember that. Why is Mark still stuck in 2020? So April 21 of 2021, we're doing another webinar on fleet safety, hidden exposures, undercovering everyday risks in workplace driving. And then also, please mark your calendars for everybody in construction. Please remember the National Safety Stand Down to Prevent Falls in Construction. Whether you're a roofer or not, we need to discuss ladder safety and preventing falls from equipment, falls from the structure, falls from heights, falls from ladders. And I would strongly encourage everybody on the webinar today to book these dates, attend the webinar, and plan to do safety meetings with your crews all week during the National Safety Stand Down to Prevent Falls in Construction. So the difference between OSHA and MEM, we know OSHA, our consultants know OSHA. We go to a lot of the same events, we know those folks. But the difference between OSHA and MEM is we look for additional best practices to help your organization stay safe. Those best practices can be things like drug-free workplace programs, new hire programs, safety programs. We look for things like written seatbelt policies, written distracted work, written distracted driving policies. We look for any best practice. We look for and use any best practice that employers can put into place to reduce injuries, any best practice. So we do see OSHA as one of those tools, but not the only tool. We support any best practice to reduce injuries and help keep your employees safe. So that's kind of the difference. We focus on injury prevention. You'll hear us say that term quite often, injury prevention. There are compliance things like confined space entry, lockout, tagout, things of those that nature that we do support and encourage as well. So we kind of do both. We kind of know OSHA, we kind of promote compliance with OSHA standards, but we also want the above and beyond as well with your company. So when we talk about construction safety, we're going to talk about some resources that are out there for you. One thing that I highly recommend as a safety consultant for construction companies is always review the top 10 most frequently cited OSHA standards. It's in the OSHA statistics page of their website. You just simply type it in. And you may want to write this down on your to-do list, which is the top 10 most frequently cited standards. Now, what I do for my construction companies is I think about which of these affect my company. So the single most commonly cited standard in the OSHA construction regs is fall protection in construction. If your employees can fall off of something, lose their balance and fall off at a distance, then we need to protect them with guardrail, nets, boom lifts, scissor lifts, personal fall arrest systems, personal fall restraint systems. Hazard communication standard in general industry, That's general industry. That's your four wall manufacturing environments. The next one would be scaffolding. Scaffolding must be set up correctly, must be planked correctly, must be plumb and level, must be in good shape. And once again, if an employee can fall, then there will be citations. Moving down, ladders and construction, number six. Are ladders set up correctly, extended 3 foot above the support edge, tied off so that they don't tip over, kick out, tip backwards, right? Number eight, fall protection. Fall protection in construction, fall protection training. Do your employees really know what they're doing when they tie off and when they use these harnesses? And then lastly, eye and face protection. Our employees are not wearing eye protection like they should. So what do I do with the top 10 list? I look at my operation and how do I fare when compared to this list? So the top 10 list is very handy. Also, I continue to dig a little bit deeper into the frequently cited standards, and you can find these PowerPoints. You can simply Google them. Fall protection in residential construction, 4,270 violations in 2019, ladders not extended 3 foot above the landing. These are rules that we're going to put in place to make sure my company doesn't get these violations. Also, when I avoid these issues, like the top 10 list, when I avoid these issues, I'm preventing incidents and injuries. Eye and face protection, so I'm going to put a safety rule in place. Everybody has to be in eye protection. If you have a tool in your hand, you need to be in eye protection. Fall protection training. Fall protection on unprotected sides and edges. Head protection, use of head protection. If there is a falling object hazard or work being done above you, then we need to be in hard hats more. Fall protection in aerial lifts, fall protection roofing work on low sloped roofs. Scaffolds, fall protection, proper guardrail on scaffolds. And then competent person job site inspections. Those are not occurring. So I would look at what I do on a construction job site and ask, how do I fare when I go out on a job site and I see these things? You can act kind of the same way a compliance safety and health officer would. You drive up on a job site and see, what do you see? What needs to be improved? OSHA's Focus 4 hazards. These are additional resources on their website. Just simply Google OSHA Focus 4 hazards. And there's plenty of training material out there for you. And I highly recommend that on these four hazards, you do this detailed training. The four hazards OSHA sees the most injuries from are falls, caught in or between, struck by, and electrocution. So there are plenty of training materials out there on the OSHA website. So I mainly wanted to share these resources with you. And then the OSHA publications. Absolutely. When we do safety for a construction company, we review the documents that OSHA puts out there free of charge, like the quick cards, fact sheets. And I review with my people exactly what the OSHA standard says. So the OSHA publications site is very handy. And then lastly, when we look at OSHA resources and a lot of the things that they have free of charge available to us, you can look at what they call the establishment search. Now, as a safety tactic, what I do is I look up not only my company to see if we've had violations, but I look up to see what my competitors do. Who are your competitors and have they had citations? Now, that's not to poke fun or generate gossip. It's to look at their citations and ask, and I would ask myself, do I have the exposure to these violations as well, which also translates exposure to injuries, right? So the establishment search is very handy, and we do refer to that. So by the numbers, let's talk about some numbers. You may want to write these down. MEM handles anywhere around 11,500 to 12,000 employee injury reports per year. We take in 30, 40, 50 injury reports every day. And last year we had around 30 worker fatalities. Now in the chat function, can anybody type in the chat function? I see Michael there. Anybody in the chat function, would you please type in what is the most common cause of employee fatality in Missouri and technically across the United States? What is the most common way to be killed on the job as an employee in the United States and in Missouri? Anybody want to type that in? Anybody want to give it a shot? Carla, she's on it. It is vehicle accidents. Now, Michael, falls is actually number two. Vehicle crash is the dangerous thing, most dangerous thing that your employees are gonna do, followed by falls. So Michael, you're right. The falls are a big problem. Falls from ladders, falls from rooftop. So congratulations. I appreciate you typing that in. Thank you very much, Carla. So 12,000 injury reports, 30 fatalities that our customers have. The average lost workday claim is $60,000. We lose around 90 days is our average on all construction lost workday claims. 90 days. So we really promote light duty programs. 40% of all MEM lost workday claims are new hires, those employed for you less than 1 year. And each of those claims will average $49,000. So we need a couple of things: written seatbelt policies, written fall prevention policies, injury management plans that require light duty. We need new hire safety training initiatives. In the state of Missouri, there were 93,163 first reports of injuries reported the Division of Work Comp, with 103 worker fatalities last year. $149,000 is the average cost of a slip, trip, and fall in construction. If you have an uninsured subcontractor and they fall, the average claim cost is $410,000. Please do not ever hire anybody to do construction work without workers' compensation insurance. 40% of all construction injuries that MEM receives are foot and ankle injuries, and they average around $96,000. And then we have a lot of ladder falls. 45% of all construction falls are from ladders. So these are some of the facts. Uninsured subcontractors are a big problem. Never hire anybody to do work with you, another contractor, unless they have workers' compensation insurance and that policy is live and active. These incidents are very expensive and very expensive for your operation. So let's keep moving. It's Groundhog Day. The top 10 list with OSHA doesn't really change. It's always falls. Vehicle crashes, they occur every day. Do you have a seatbelt policy? Slip, trip, fall. These incidents happen every day. Orthopedic injuries, strain, sprain, overexertion, they happen every day. And the question I'm going to ask for everybody listening in today is, what are you doing about these things? Are we doing enough safety meetings? Are we doing enough job site safety meetings? When was the last time our employees actually sat down and read over the safety plan? So I'm asking you, what are we actually doing to prevent falls in construction incidents, eye injuries, slip, trip, fall injuries, ladder falls, vehicle crashes? And some thoughts. Here's some theory. Loss prevention and loss control. You'll hear these terms tossed around in insurance pretty often. Loss prevention. The purpose is to keep employees on the job and injury-free. Loss control. Maintain lower costs and protect human resources through safety and proper claims management. Loss control, proper claims management. And some thoughts on the definition of loss. You'll hear the words loss turned around and kicked around in insurance quite a bit. Losses have two components. One, the acute injury occurred in the first place. You have the injury, which safety combats the injuries. But then when the injury occurs, that injury actually has to be managed correctly to get the employee back to work as soon as possible and healthy and keep claims costs as low as possible. So those are some things to think about. So some things, some additional things to think about that I would need everybody on the webinar to kind of assess in their own operation. What are your current insurance costs? I work with a lot of employers that don't know what they're paying for workers' compensation insurance. They don't know what their EMOD rate is. Current and past work comp claims. Your old work comp claims can still tell a story. Go back and look through your losses, your old work comp claims, and say, what could have been done differently? What could have been done better? What can I learn from those? And then what is the status of any current open claims? I do see that pretty often where employers disengage in the claims process. And I don't believe in that. We need to stay engaged. Relationship with the carrier and agency. Do you use MEM resources? Do you use agency resources? Your current safety policy, plan, rules, whatever you want to call it, have they been communicated to employees? Are safety meetings occurring regularly? Are safety rules enforced? And I'll tell you, this is my opinion. One of the hardest things that we have to do as employers is enforce those rules. The safety plan that is not enforced has no value. So don't bother writing it. I want and expect everybody, if when they see a safety violation or some sort of a safety issue, to deal with that, okay? And then do we have an injury management plan? These are things to think about. I like a two-part safety and risk management program. I like a two-part program. Maybe this will be helpful. Part one is what activities are occurring before the incident that help prevent the incident. So look at that in your own company. What things are happening in your company to help prevent incidents? These would be things like inspections of tools, equipment, machines, work areas. Okay, drug-free workplace policy for new hires. Post-offer employment physical testing for new hires, regular and routine training, job site safety meetings, job site inspections, accountability and enforcement. These things help prevent incidents. So look in your own operation. What things are you doing to prevent the incident? And secondly, if an incident were to occur, are we ready to provide that treatment, work with MEM, get that employee healed up and back to work as soon as possible? And these are activities after the incident to control costs and return employees back to duty. And that is an injury management plan. Safety plan to prevent, injury management plan to control costs. Now, the EMOD rate is huge. In construction, generally speaking, we all talk. If most general contractors don't like to hire companies with an EMOD rate over one. The EMOD rate is unique to workers' compensation insurance. It's literally there to punish employers financially if they have more incidents. You're going to get charged more. These are dollars spent on employee injury claims. If you have a ton of dollars spent on employee injury claims, then you will eventually get an increased EMOD rate. Now, if you're doing a lot of safety stuff and your EMOD rate is falling, you're under a 1.0, then that's great. You're going to see savings. So some things to think about. If you're under one, let's say the 0.8 here in this graphic, then that 0.8 means that you're saving 20% over the 1.0 mod. The 1.0 mod is a C grade. It's average in the industry. It's what your competitors are doing. So you're saving 20%. But if you're over one, let's say the 1.2, you're paying 20% more. And so on. The goal is to keep the injuries down, the injury costs down, to keep the EMOD rate down. If you have a higher EMOD rate, higher than 1.0 or higher, then our goal would be to get that EMOD rate down through safety and proper claims management. And here is one example of a screenshot I grabbed of a company that has a 1.58 mod rate. They're paying 58% more for work comp insurance. Their premium is $560,000. With the average mod being 1.0, they could be paying, through improved safety and claims management, $354,000. But we looked to see what their minimum mod could be. They could reduce their mod down to 0.67, which means they could have a premium go from $560,000 down to $237,000. They're leaving $322,000 on the table every year. So these are things to think about. What is your mod? And what can we do to get that down? And what can we do to keep it down? Because that means employees are safer, we're managing claims properly, and your company is going to be more successful financially. The current mod that you have is not based on claims that happened this year, and it's not based on claims that happened last year, because most claims take about a year and a half to get completely closed. So we don't count them on this year or last year's policies. Or we don't count the claims on this year's policy and last year's. We count the ones that are on the 3 years prior to that. So if you're an 8-1, a 20, if you're an 8-1 policy year, then 16 to 17, 17 to 18, and claims 18 to 19 are being counted, but not 19 to 20, not 20 to 21. So that's kind of what's going on. But I want you to think about it like this. If you have an incident today on March 16th of 21, notice I typed in 21 this time instead of 2020. My goodness. If you have an incident today, it won't go on this policy year's E-mod rate. It won't go on next year's policy's E-mod rate. It will hit 22 to 23, 23 to 24, 24 to 25. It'll stay on those 3 years, and it will fall off 25 to 26, 25, 26. That's kind of wild to think about it like that. Injuries have a long tail, and they last a long time. So we have to start today. Start today. On your to-do list, do something today to make your company safer. Something today. It could be something as simple as sending an email to everybody. It could be something as simple as going down to see employees as they leave for the day to remind them to wear their seatbelts. Do something today. Why injuries occur and why are costs so high? Minimal or no safety activities occurring. I do a lot of training. I do a lot of webinars. I do webinars every day, and I ask employees, when was the last time you saw the safety plan? And it is shocking when employees that are out there doing the work tell me, I've never seen it. When was the last time you did a safety meeting? March 16th of 2021, and I still have employees telling me that they haven't had one this year and can't remember the last one they came to. We're getting complacent. We need to make sure our employees get regular safety meetings, and you as the employer need to set your expectations. Minimal or no safety activities occurring. Or if the incident occurs, there is very poor medical management. We don't have directed medical care. We don't have light duty. We don't do post-injury drug and alcohol testing. We don't direct medical care, so our employees go wherever they want. And this is a problem. And we need to understand that for every dollar in direct cost that we have after an incident, there could be $4 to $10 under the waterline that we're paying for, and that's causing additional stress on our company, an organization. Just for giggles, go back in your old losses, in the old claims on the loss run, on your old loss run, and look at how much the claim closed for, and just multiply it times $4 to $10. And make that a safety meeting topic with your management staff and say, listen, we had the incident, this is what it cost from a work comp standpoint, but we also had a damaged truck. We also had to clean up some landscaping where the truck went through the yard when it crashed. We also had to bring in a temporary employee. We had to hire a new employee. We had to train that person. How much do these things cost after an injury? So remember the iceberg effect. So on construction job sites, things to think about before we even begin. Identify safety needs before we even send anybody out there to begin that excavation, to begin all of it. Are there issues with trenching? Are there going to be issues with utilities or roofing? Are we going to have falls from heights? Yes. On all of these construction job sites, we will have trenching issues, roofing issues, fall from heights issues on all of them. Bricklayers, framers, truss setting, sheeting the roof, scaffolds. What safety rules need to be in place? What safety meetings need to occur? What injury management plan do we have? You may have a Columbia crew that works in Sedalia. Well, are there injury management resources or OCMED physicians in Sedalia that can help? Setting these plans in place before we even begin any work. Verifying that our subcontractors are insured. Doing safety meetings on a daily basis. We talk about doing safety meetings, but my personal opinion is monthly safety meetings aren't enough. That job site has strain, sprain, orthopedic issues. It has falls from height issues. It has falls from ladder issues. It has fleet issues. How many of your construction crews drive hours on a regular basis to get to these job sites? Then they work all day and they're extremely fatigued and they have to drive home. So I think we really need to plan to do daily safety meetings. So Michael and Carla and folks that are chatting in to the chat function, I want to ask a question. How long, if I had four or five people on a job site, how long should a safety meeting last? Anybody want to type that in? What's your opinion? If you do a safety meeting, how long should it last? Carla says 5 minutes. How long should it last? Michael, anybody want to type in their opinion? What's your opinion? Is there a set standard? Does a safety meeting always have to go an hour? Do we always have to have it with folding chairs and tables in a sanitized meeting room? Or can it be like Carla says and last 5 minutes? Can I make my point in 5 minutes? Kimberly says 15. Can I make my point in just a few minutes? And I believe we can. I think when I say safety meetings, yeah, and Michael says as long as it needs to be, right? Because, you know, some topics may last only a few seconds. Other topics may last several minutes. But the point is, I think when we say safety meetings, people automatically think an hour or a half hour. That's not true. If we're doing a safety meeting on seatbelts, how long should that take? It shouldn't take very long. But we need to be stern about these things. This is what I expect. But I do think daily safety meetings are important. And one of the most important things that we carry in our vehicles is our notepad and pen. I really just don't think we're documenting things. I think you're doing safety meetings. I know you're talking about safety. I think we need to get better at documenting these things. So let's keep moving. I think inspections are critical. They're an offensive tactic. I think enforcement's critical. What happens in your company if an unsafe actor condition is discovered? Just think about that. What actually happens? Do we perform inspections? Because OSHA is. You can do those inspections yourself and you can correct these issues before somebody sees this. Are they documented? Who performs them? And is documented corrective action being done? We hope so. If you need a corrective action sample form, we have those and we can send them to you. The mem-ins.com website has a forms section, and you want to take a look at that because there's some documents there that might help you. New hires are critical. We hire in people for the spring. That's why we did the meeting today in the spring before construction companies really start hiring and putting people to work big time. New hires are critical. 40% of all lost workday claims that come into MEM are new hires. Things that we recommend, post-offer drug-free workplace, post-offer new hire drug screening, drug-free workplace new hire screening, post-offer employment physicals. Is that new hire actually physically capable of doing that work? We have an agreement with the company that helps us do those. Is your new hire actually physically capable of doing the work? Are we doing initial training with our employees and sitting them down to discuss safety rules and setting safety expectations? Are we spending some time with them and monitoring their work and correcting unsafe acts or conditions or concerns? So these are things to think about. New hires are absolutely a focus, and MEM has a new hire packet on the website that I will send out as part of this webinar today. And we really like new hire checklists. We really like it when management sits down with new hires, foreman, and sits down with them to say, listen, these are the things that we expect. Here's your safety gear. Follow these rules. You'll get more advanced training as you spend a little bit more time with the company. Fall protection is huge. On construction job sites, we are concerned with falls during truss setting, falls during framing, falls from ladders, falls from roll around scaffolds, falls from rooftops when we're sheeting, when we're roofing. If they can fall, if they can lose their balance and fall, then MEM wants them to be protected. So I need you to look at your company and what you do and what situations do we run into where employees can fall simply by losing their balance and fall a distance. A conversation that I had with Carla's employees is, does height matter? Does height matter? Because we actually had an employee fall 6 feet and sustained a broken neck and became a quadriplegic. So the height can sometimes be, we've had people fall and were seriously injured from a standing position. So fall protection is huge. If they can fall and be seriously injured, fall to the floor below, fall to the concrete, then they need to be protected. We have concerns with leading edge work, ladder safety, hiring people correctly and actually training them, and in a written safety plan that's actually enforced. Moving ahead, ladders. I'm going to continue to, in any construction webinar, we will talk about ladders. We'll always talk about ladders. They're extremely dangerous. If you would look at the MEM website and search for ladders last, MEM also has a podcast that you're going to want to check out. Richard Jones, safety director, retired safety director with Turner Construction, joined MEM to promote their Ladders Last program. And we decided to take that program corporate. And you'll see MEM's Ladders Last program on our website. We encourage you to take a look at it and consider that process for your company. Develop ladder safety rules, inspect these ladders regularly for problems. 3 points of contact would be a safety rule that we would enforce. Don't overload the ladders, tie them off, secure them so they won't tip out. Tip over, and then use ropes and lifts more often. That's what we like. If the employee can fall off, then we would want them protected, and we would write recommendations, urgent or important recommendations, so that your company would fix those immediately. If we were to come on the job site and see something like this, the employee can fall. He is simply relying on his balance. He could easily fall to the ground and be severely injured. So we like routine job site inspections, correct ladders for the job, fall arrest systems on things like these ladder jacks, extending these ladders properly, tying them off, training the employees. So let's keep moving. We see photos like this in our view. This type of thing would be unacceptable. When we have people working 18, 20 feet up with zero protection, and they could easily fall and be seriously injured. Also, working from ladders is one thing, but we need to have them set up correctly, and we always have to maintain 3 points of contact. So these are just a couple of examples. So the Ladders Last program, what is the Ladders Last program that I mentioned earlier? It is choosing a tool or a piece of equipment like a boom lift or a scissor lift or a scaffold, some other tool that is safer than using a ladder. Ladders, folks can, their knees can buckle, they can lose balance, they can be afraid of heights. Anything could go wrong, wind, and cause somebody to fall from a ladder. Mounting and dismounting the ladder is unsafe. So we think that we could use something else, maybe a boom lift. Do you have access to a boom lift? They make a lot of different lightweight scissor lifts that are designed for using inside the building. So there's a lot of options out there now that weren't there a few years ago, and ladders, it's our opinion that if we can find a safer method, let's go ahead and do that. So we have a Ladders Last podcast, we have a Ladders Last webpage. You can find that on MEM-INS. So Terry mentions in the chat function, what type of safety meeting occurs after an injury? after an injury, well, that is reactive. We want to look at specific causes of accidents and how to prevent that injury from occurring in the future. Short 10-minute safety meetings help. So these are things to think about. Moving ahead. Concerns that we have in construction, especially residential construction, wood frame constructions, truss setting, carpentry, falls from heights, falls when trusses tip over, falls when trusses break, employees that have not spread their weight out across multiple trusses, falls from significant heights. No matter what they're doing, if they can fall off of it, it's not going to be permitted. We need to use gear and use a different variety of gear depending on the phase of construction. Can employees be falled? Well, they need to be, can employees fall? Then they need to be protected from that fall. And something that we've kicked around for residential truss setting is things like the double retractable lanyard. We like the double retractable lanyard so they can tie off to multiple trusses at once and spread their weight out. So these are just some options. Columbia Safety in Columbia, Missouri can help you with that. We have a lot of folks standing in the trusses. The truss breaks because they're on a knot and down they go. So what can we do to prevent that? Can we spread the weight out by standing on boards? Can we double tie off? We're not sophisticated enough yet to have the sky hook, but we'll get there one of these days, right? And then seatbelt policy. How far do your employees drive to do their work? We unfortunately see a lot of vehicle crashes every day. We like distracted driving policies. We like written seatbelt policies that are enforced. We also really like telematics. You may investigate telematics for your fleet. Can you see what your trucks are doing, how fast they're going, where they're at, and can you identify unsafe situations like hard braking, rapid acceleration, okay, and speeding? So these are policies that MEM would want you to put in place. So offensive safety measures, and then we'll also talk about controlling costs. It's 12:42. We'll be wrapping up the presentation by 1. So offensive safety measures. Let's think about these things. The offensive tactic to reduce your exposure to injury. Job site inspections. Enforcement of safety rules. Providing PPE. Using the ladders last program and removing ladders when we can simply use boom lifts. Doing those safety meetings. Reviewing the safety plan on a regular basis. That's the offensive tactic, to go out and find these issues and deal with them. And then having an injury management plan to control loss costs after something happens. So this is the top 10 list. Well, there's 11 there. Top 11 list, which I will send this PowerPoint to you. Management must commit. Supervisors, foremen, mid-level management, the top boss must say that we don't want any unsafe acts and conditions on these job sites, and we're going to fix them. You're going to need to understand your cost. What is your current premium? What is your EMOD rate? Have employees seen safety rules lately? Have we done regular safety meetings and job site safety meetings, just-in-time safety meetings? Perform corrective action. When an employee doesn't wear their PPE or doesn't wear their safety gear, what happens? Do we actually document this? Do we have a discussion with them? Do we go out and inspect job sites? Job site inspections are the best because you find problems before they find your people. We've got to do more job site inspections. Enforce the drug-free workplace policy. We usually talk about the drug-free workplace plan when HR gets everybody together each year to do open enrollment, et cetera. But we need to regularly discuss drug-free workplaces with our employees on a regular basis, regularly. Don't just leave it to a one-year thing. Employees need to know that we do new hire testing and we do post-incident testing. Written seatbelt policy. Written distracted work policy. I do see cell phones as causing problems with employees out on the job because they're running a tool with one hand and they're on the phone with the other. So maybe we need to expand it to distracted work policy. You can have a phone, but it's for emergencies only. And then also the distracted driving as part of the distracted work policy. New hires, we need to have a new hire training program where we talk to sit down with our employees. And then we really like post-offer employment physicals. Is the prospective employee actually physically capable of doing the work? Questions that we're going to ask. When was the last time your employees actually saw the written safety plan? When have they signed it last? Randomly pull a file and look to see. When was the last safety meeting your employees actually attended? When was the last time corrective action was actually performed with an employee if there was an unsafe act or condition, which shows that we enforce our safety rules? Does anybody perform documented safety inspections? These are things to think about. Now, we like at MEM to address top-down exposures. Slip, trip, fall, strain, sprain, orthopedic incident, vehicle crash, and then what we call struck or injured by. So with OSHA, as we discussed, we look at the top 10 list, most frequently cited standards, right? We want to hone in on that. We want to focus in on the focus four job site hazards. And then with MEM, we look at slip, trip, fall, strain, sprain, vehicle crash, and then struck or injured by. And the question I would ask your company is I would look at, is there any documented evidence of slip, trip, and fall prevention? Things like ice cleats when it's super icy out and we have to work, ladder's last policy, three-point contact, ladder safety, fall arrest systems, documented evidence of overexertion prevention, that could be post-offer employment physical testing, the proper tools like dollies and lifts and things of that nature, using forklifts instead of your back, documented evidence of vehicle crash prevention, driver training, MVRs, telematics, seatbelts, distracted driving policies, and then documented evidence of struck or injured by, eye protection, helmets, things that strike and injure our hands. So that's what we would look for, training, policy and procedure, equipment. Let's keep moving. Thoughts on tackling injuries? Once again, when was the last time our policies were acknowledged? Now, a thought, it's 12:47, a thought. And you can type this in if you would like to everybody that feels comfortable chatting in the answer. Is signing your safety plan or program or whatever you call it, is sitting down with your employees on an annual basis and signing it on an annual basis enough to be effective? Anybody want to type that in? And this is a philosophical discussion I think about with other safety people, and we talk about this at safety meetings. Is signing the safety plan once a year enough? Is once a year enough to change behavior and make things safer? Anybody want to type that in? We usually do. Safety people and business owners, we sign policies once a year. But is it really enough? We want to prevent injuries, and we want to go an entire year without an injury. I personally don't think it's enough. So you have a safety plan. If it's a great big thick thing, let's be reasonable. Can your employees really read that great big thick safety plan once a year and it actually do any good? I don't think so. And also something to think about too, when we hire new people, we hand them a great big thick safety binder. And what does the very last page of the safety binder say? It says, I have read and understood everything in this binder, sign here. That's not fair, because you know as well as I did that they didn't read any of it. So I think break the safety plan down into regular chunks. I think we need to cover it more often than not. And when I do safety meetings with your company, if you invited MEM to do that safety, webinar with your company or on-site training, then we would, as part of that deal, have all employees re-sign the safety plan, and we would actually look at it while I'm there. So I think we need to do that more often. Have we reached every employee with a safety message? Third shift, part-timers, have we addressed unsafe acts and conditions? You'll see a theme. It's everything that we talk about at MEM. Have we enforced safety rules lately? Have job sites, buildings, and equipment been inspected? Are new hires addressed? But are they rewarded when things go right? One thing we do like is a fraud-resistant safety incentive program based on inspections and our employees fit for duty. OSHA fines are out there. You can see these. They are expensive. One of the things that Terry and I worked on years ago, she had a poster made up that said that she would put on a job site that said, "Hey, OSHA, stop here," with a big exclamation point. And her point to the crew was, what does OSHA think when they drive by our job site? So I would ask you that. What does OSHA think when they drive by? What are they going to see? Well, if they see these things, then these things also result in injuries. So that's a tactic that I like. So the injury management plan for construction companies, we like an injury reporting policy. Put it in policy that you do light duty, you do post-incident drug and alcohol testing, that you do have company-directed medical and you like to go to certain OCMEDs, okay, that you want the injury reported in writing before that employee goes home for the day. And that the supervisor foreman needs to turn it in to HR. HR calls MEM. The employee needs to report by the end of the day in writing, and the employer needs to have that incident report to MEM to start a claim number within 24 hours. Require post-incident drug and alcohol screening within 24 hours. Require written incident statements by end of the day workday. Perform injury investigations. Maybe it was somebody else that caused the injury, and maybe we could subrogate, which is looking at other insurance to help you with your cost. Policyholder, we want our policyholders to report all injuries to us within 24 hours, a report only incident report, a med only incident report, or a lost workday claim incident report. Develop a company directed medical plan. MEM has a partnership with CorVel, and you can find treatment providers that are in the CorVel network, which will save you a lot of money. Offer light duty, return to work, 70% on EMR reduction. So if you offer light duty and you bring the employee back to work and you keep the claim med only, because you have three types of claim, report only, med only, and then lost workday claim, lost time claim. If the employee is brought back to work before it triggers the lost time claim, then you could see a 70% reduction as to how those claims dollars are rolled into the EMOD rate. So if you had 5,000 in treatment, then only 1,500 of it would be reflected in the EMOD rate. But you have light duty. NCCI loves light duty. We at MEM love light duty. We see better medical results with light duty. Communication with the employee that has been injured, and communication with the carrier if something changes. What is the number one, the most common reason why an employee would get an attorney during the injury management process? Because they don't know. Nobody told them. So I'm a really big fan of being upfront, open, and honest, and publishing out the injury management plans. Everybody can see it and everybody knows what's coming. Moving ahead, asking for trouble. These things cause employers' costs to rise. Lack of timely reporting. Lack of investigation, no drug-free workplace program, no written safety rules, no directed medical care, no timely return to work, no proof of safety enforcement, lack of a plan, employees are confused, and they may perceive that they're not being told the truth. Lack of communication with employees, lack of communication with the carrier like MEM. So we want to have a plan that helps us all avoid these things. When we have these things out there, it could lead to big problems during the claims management process. So really quickly, reviewing your losses. The past losses are important. Why did the incident occur in the first place, and why were costs not contained? Safety rules are everywhere. Look at your machines, tools, and equipment. Take those safety rules and put them in a document. One of the things we don't do as safety people very often, or when we're doing safety meetings, is we don't walk around a machine and specifically talk about each warning label. We probably should. We don't read owner's manuals very well. We don't read things like safety data sheets very well. We don't fill out the inspections like we should. that are actually provided with the machine. So that's where you can get safety rules that you can put on one document. Now, we've talked about this big safety plan, and your company may need a big safety plan. But with all big safety plans, what I like to do is boil them down to one page. Can you boil the most important safety rules down to one page? So the question I would have for everybody on the call here today, what does it take to be safe in your company? And you need to answer that question. For an employee to be safe in your company, what do they need to do? Well, they need to wear their safety gear. They need to wear their eye protection. They need to wear their fall protection. They need to report to work free from drugs or alcohol. They need to drive with their seatbelt on. They need to put their phone up when they're driving. They need to drive the speed limit. Put those on one sheet of paper. And doesn't that make things way easier when we're communicating the most important safety rules? And I will send this example out to everybody in my email. Example of a one-page list of safety rules. We have our safety rules. We do regular safety training and acknowledgement where we sign off on those safety rules. Then at that point, it's up to the employer to perform corrective action if there's a problem and inspect to see if those rules are followed. You have a safety rule, so now we have to make sure they're followed. And we would document that. Moving ahead, no matter what you call it, safety rules, if they're in the overall, you have an overall company safety plan, that's great. But you may have safety rules in your handbook. You may have the handbook with safety in it, that's fine. And then you probably will also need machine or tool or job specific rules like lockout, tagout, or confined space entry. That's fine. But no matter what rules or where you have them, they need to be updated and sent out to the employees on a regular basis. And I recommend more than once a year. So we start with rules that address top losses and fines. We enforce those construction safety rules. We're direct. No unwritten safety rules. Get all rules on paper in plain language. Routinely review them with employees and document every time we do a safety meeting. There are penalties in Missouri's work comp law. And to work on wrapping up, I want everybody to know that when you have trained, enforced, educated, fair, commonly known safety rules, that when an employee fails to follow a safety rule, that there could be penalties in the work comp law. They fail to follow the written safety rule and they are subsequently injured. So that's something to think about. Missouri legislature does support your safety rules. Same with drug-free workplace. If the employee tests positive after an incident, there could be a 50% penalty on work comp benefits. And there's examples here of positive tests for marijuana, no seatbelt, et cetera, where MEM took the penalty. So we do that, and we save around $49,000, I believe it is, per claim when the safety rules or drug-free workplace rules are taken, the penalties are taken. So things to think about when we consider a penalty, be specific. That's the main thing to remember. Be specific. No generalized safety rules like obey all traffic laws. Let's be specific. Follow the speed limit, wear a seatbelt, don't drive distracted. And you can actually defend your company with OSHA when you have inspections, training, enforcement, and a plan. And you can show OSHA that you are managing the safety process. And you have maybe an employee that is breaking these rules when OSHA shows up on a job site. So that's the employee misconduct affirmative defense. You can see information out on OSHA's website on this. But your employees have to be trained and the employer has to enforce the policy. But you can defend yourself from OSHA citations. Hopefully with the safety plan that's trained and educated and enforced, you wouldn't have these OSHA citations. But if something were to happen, your documentation will help. Any questions? It's 12:59. I'm looking at the chat function. Are there any questions? Does anybody have questions? Now I've typed in my contact info. You can always email me after the webinar. You can always call. Are there any questions? Was this helpful? Is this a helpful webinar? I certainly hope it was helpful for everybody. It is being recorded. We're going to look at putting it out on I believe YouTube or something to that effect for everybody. I'm going to send out this PowerPoint and supplemental resources to go with it. If there are no questions, we'll work on wrapping up. I cannot say thank you enough to everybody that joined us. I certainly hope that the content was helpful for you. You have your marching order and your orders and your content there for your to-do list. Let's do one thing today to make our employees, employer, and our work safer in our operation. And it is 1 o'clock. I'm going to work on wrapping up. If there are no questions coming in a chat function, and there are none coming in, I'm going to wrap up. Thank you, everybody.